Let's review chapter 27. So our first question here deals with net present value. So we're told that Sullivan Company is considering two different capital expenditure proposals. Project A, will have a cost of $450,000, has an expected useful life of 11 years, a salvage value of zero, and is expected to increase net annual cash flows by $73,500. Project B will cost $300,000, has an expected useful life of 11 years, a salvage value of zero, and is expected to increase net annual cash flows by $50,000. So a discount rate of 9% is appropriate for both projects. What we need to do is we need to compute the net present value for each and then figure out which project should be accepted. So we're going to start off with project A. And we have this table of interest factors to find the present value of an annuity. So we're told that project A will increase our annual cash flows by $73,500. We want to know what that's worth. So we start off by taking a look at our number of years, which we're told is an expected useful life of 11 years. So that's why the 11 is circled down the left side. Up along the top is our 9% discount rate. And we see where they meet. It gives us an interest factor of the 6.805. So we're going to use that interest factor now to find the present value of our net annual cash flows. So we take that $73,500, multiply it by that interest factor, and that tells us that the present value of all of those cash flows throughout the 11 years is worth a little bit more than $500,000. Now, to find the net present value, what we do is we compare the present value that we just found to the initial cost or the capital investment. Well, our initial cost is $450,000. So when we subtract those two, we get a net present value of $50,181.47. So that's the net present value for project A. Doesn't really tell us anything until we find it for project B to know whether or not this is good enough. So for project B, we had the same number of useful years and the same discount rate. It was 11 years and 9%. So we're going to have this same interest factor here, that 6.8. But what changes is our net annual cash flows. Here, that's only $50,000. So $50,000 times our interest factor gets us $340,000. Then we subtract out our capital investment of $300,000. So the net present value for project B is $40,259.50. So now we can compare our two different net present values. For project A, it's at a little over $50,000. Project B is a little over $40,000. The fact that both are positive would mean that both are acceptable projects, right? We want a net present value to be positive. But there's one that's clearly better than the other, and that's project A, because project A has a higher net present value. So if you have multiple projects and you're going to use net present value to figure out which one you should accept, you're going to accept the one with the higher net present value. Now let's talk about cash payback period. So we're told that Owen Company is considering two new projects. Both projects will last for 5 years and will require an investment of $35,000. The projects will produce the following net annual cash flows. So you see that project A has different cash flows each year. Year one, they'll bring in $8,000. Year two, $12,000. Year three, $7,000. Right, for a total of $75,000 at the end of 5 years. Project B has equal cash flows. So we're going to be able to figure out the two different ways to solve for a cash payback period. One, when it's non-equal cash flows, like in Project A, and the other way when we have equal cash flows, like in Project B. So Owen Company will not accept any project with a cash payback period over 3 years, which means that they want to be able to make back their investment of $35,000 within 3 years. If it's more than that, they're not interested. So what we need to do is we need to compute the cash payback period for both projects and then figure out which project to go with. So let's start off with project A. So we're given all of our net annual cash flows. And when they're different from year to year, like we have here in project A, we're going to want to build a table like this where we have our years, net annual cash flows, and then cumulative cash flows. So we can see that after year one, we've had cash flows of $8,000. Then year two happens, and we have cash flows of an additional $12,000, which means that after year two, we've now made $20,000 in cash. So what we're going to try to do here is figure out at what point does our cumulative cash flows exceed the initial investment of $35,000. So after year two, we're still short of that $35,000. Year three happens. Another $7,000 of cash flows comes in. So our cumulative cash flows here is $27,000. Then year four happens. Year four, we get a lot of cash, right? We get $25,000. So we add that to our 27, and we see that in year four, our cumulative cash flows exceed that initial $35,000. So we know that sometime in year four, we are going to make back our initial investment. But we need to figure out when in year four, right? So the way that we're going to do that is we're going to take the initial cost of $35,000 and subtract it by the $27,000 that we have made up through year three, right? So that's going to tell us that going into year four, we still had to make another $8,000 in cash flows. So that's step one, is to find that $8,000. Now, we're going to assume that the $25,000 in cash that we get in year four is evenly spread out throughout the year. So making that assumption, we can then figure out at what point in year four did we hit $8,000 of cash flows. So to do that, we take the $8,000 divided by the $25,000 that we have for year four, and we see that 0.32 is our answer. That means that roughly a third of the way through year four, we hit that $8,000 in cash flows, which means that we made back our initial investment of $35,000. Now, our cash payback period is not just this 0.32. This 0.32 tells you how far through year four we made back that money, which means that our cash payback period is 3 full years plus an additional 0.32. So we get this 3.32 years. So for project A, about 3 years and 4 months would be our cash payback period. Now let's figure it out for project B. Now for project B, we could once again make a table like we did here for project A. And we could go year by year and figure out at what point did our cumulative cash flows exceed the initial investment. But you can notice over on the left that Project B's annual cash flows are all equal. And when they're all equal, figuring out the cash payback period is a lot easier. So we see this equation on the screen now, right? Cash payback period equals the cost of capital investment divided by the net annual cash flow. So whenever our net annual cash flows are equal, like in Project B, we can use this equation. So the cost of our capital investment, that's our $35,000, divided by the $14,000 that we're getting every year. And we see that the cash payback period is 2.5 years. So project B has a cash payback period of 2.5 years. Project A has a cash payback period of 3.32 years. So notice that what this means is that in project B, we're getting our money quicker. So even though the total for project B is less than the total for project A, when we add up all of our annual cash flows, project B is going to get us back our initial investment faster than project A. Which means when we need to determine which one is more desirable, we are going to go with project B. Because project B gets us back our initial investment sooner. We can also eliminate project A by that first sentence that we see there. Owen Company will not accept any project with a cash payback period over 3 years. Well, project A has a cash payback period of over 3 years. So Owen Company wouldn't be interested in that. Project B, however, we get our money back in 2.5 years. So that's the project that we're going to go with. Now let's talk about annual rate of return. So Pierre's hair salon is considering opening a new location. The cost of building a new salon is $300,000. A new salon will generate annual revenues of $60,000, with annual expenses including depreciation of $42,000. At the end of 15 years, the salon will have a salvage value of $80,000. With all of that information, we can calculate the annual rate of return on the project. So here's the equation that we're going to use. The expected annual net income divided by our average investment. So we're given all of the pieces in the upper right to solve for those. So we'll first figure out our expected annual net income. We're told that the new salon will generate annual revenues of $60,000 and have annual expenses of $42,000. So revenues minus expenses tells us that our expected annual net income is $18,000. Now, average investment, what we do here is we take the original investment, so the original cost of building this new salon, which we're told is $300,000. We add in the value at the end of its useful life. Here we have this $80,000 salvage value. So we add those two amounts together and divide by two. So we'll have $380,000 divided by two, which gives us the average investment of $190,000. So we now have our expected annual net income of $18,000 and the average investment of $190,000. So we plug those back into the annual rate of return equation, and we get an annual rate of return of 9.47%.